everybody. Welcome to Reassessing Inequality and Reimagining the 21st Century East Harlem Case Study. This is our final class that's going to be live streamed. We will be having a community celebration and get together at La Casa Azul on Friday, May 17th at 6:30, and everybody's invited to come see the students' final projects. My name is Caitlin Cahill, and I'm a co-instructor of the class along with Wendy Luttrell. I'm going to start by introducing Professor Laura Pulido from the Department of American Studies and Ethnicity at the University of Southern California. Professor Pulido researches race, political activism, Chicana studies, critical human geography, and Los Angeles. She studies how various groups experience racial and class oppression, how these experiences differ among particular communities of color, and how they mobilize to create a more socially just world. Asking such questions, Professor Pulido has done extensive work in the field of environmental justice, social movements, labor studies, and radical tourism, including the book that we read for today, A People's Guide to Los Angeles, that she co-authored. In this book, she unpacks relationships of power and inequality and linked processes of urban development, displacement, and resistance, and how they structure everyday life, not only here, but across the entire Los Angeles metropolitan area and beyond. She makes plain how our everyday geographies are sites for struggles for justice, rights, and claims for space. These are the themes that have characterized much of her work, including, for example, her award-winning book, which also focuses on her hometown, Black, Brown, Yellow, and Left, Radical Activism in Los Angeles, where she traces the roots of multiracial alliances and third world radicalism in the 1960s and 70s and the implications for today. Laura Pulido's work is at once historical and very much about this very moment. And so just here is a few lines from the conclusion of that book that I feel like she's kind of singing. She writes so beautifully. So activists must dream in order to develop a vision of the kind of world they want to live in. The visions offered must be compassionate and humane. Although a vision is no guarantee of successfully remaking the world, it is a necessary first step. And she ends with the confidence that living arrangements can be devised where everybody can be fed and the planet healed, but it will take profound change and willingness if we wish to get there. We do. So here, here. Pulido's scholarship is a step forward, I think, in feeding all of us. And wonderful to end our semester with her work and with the work of Ruth Gilmore as well. So I was first introduced to Laura Pulido's work in her brilliant book, Environmentalism and Economic Justice, Two Chicano Studies Struggles in the Southwest, and also her seminal piece on environmental racism and white privilege that I recommend for everybody. And these works were, for me, a breath of fresh air and critical interventions in the field of geography, which is noteworthy because of its blind spot towards critical questions of structural racism and privilege. So we're most grateful for your work. Thank you. And now Wendy's going to introduce Ruth Gilmore. So,
well, we're really honored tonight to have both of them Skyping in from places far away. Ruth Gilmore is in Portugal, and it's midnight there, so we're especially grateful for her staying up late to be with us. And Laura is Skyping in from Los Angeles. I have the special honor and privilege of introducing Professor Gilmore, who joined the Graduate Center faculty in 2010. And for the past 3 years, she has spent here dazzling and inspiring students, faculty, and staff with her energy, insights, reach as a genuinely interdisciplinary scholar, and her commitment to activist, or perhaps it would be more accurate to say her revolutionary research agenda. And that gets acknowledged not just by me using that language, but by last year her nationally recognized award of the Angela Davis Award for Public Scholarship by the American Studies Association, which a couple years ago, she also was the president of. And this award recognizes scholars who conduct research that has directly served the public good. which of course is one of the basic tenets of what we've been trying to explore together, learn together, work together in terms of community partnerships throughout this course. And I think it's just wonderful that we have the participation of the quintessential public scholar with us tonight. She also has published an award-winning book that we got to read a chapter of tonight, Gold Gulag, Prisons, Surplus, Crisis, and Opposition in Globalizing California, which beyond providing an eye-opening political, economic, and cultural history of the system of incarceration, also lifts up sites of grassroots resistance that might otherwise go unrecognized. Professor Gilmore is also internationally known for her work on race and ethnicity, labor and social movements, the environment, the African diaspora, and revolution and reform, including a piece in the groundbreaking anthology, and I love this title, The Revolution Will Not Be Funded, Beyond the Nonprofit Industrial Complex. As an activist scholar, she is lauded for her ongoing work with grassroots organizations and community groups, especially those working to abolish the prison system. It's really not by chance that we close our semester's readings with a chapter from her book that tells the most remarkable story of Mother's Rock, a reclamation project that's spearheaded by mothers who refused to accept the disposal or what Cindy Katz would call the wasting of their children. Her chapter resonates with an ongoing theme in this course about how love, respect, recognition, solidarity, and a sense of identity and belonging, as well as dignity, are all products of collective care, and that the basic condition of humanity, its daily maintenance and generational reproduction, depend on assertions of care justice that the Mother's Rock refused to give up on. Speaking of the lessons learned from their multiracial mobilization against state violence, Professor Gilmore writes, and this is one of my favorite lines of the book, "If it takes a village to raise a child, it certainly takes a movement to undo an occupation." Thank you, Professor Gilmore, for providing us a vision of our collective responsibility to make a movement that refuses to give up on any group of children to be viewed as disposable. Thank you both for being here, and we are very eager to have not only a dialogue between the two of you, but also with those of us who are here tonight. I don't know if you all talked before who wanted to go first, but it's completely up to you. Laura?
Yes, sir. Is that right?
That's good.
Thank you. Those were very wonderful introductions, very generous. And it's always so great to me to hear people introduce my friend. So I know the theme today is people, right? And I'm really going to talk both about, primarily about kind of social movements, but also about activism and other forms of resistance towards the end. But really my point of entry is social movements. I have been interested in social movements ever since I can remember, probably starting around when I was 5 or 6 years old, and I saw these images like of the civil rights movement on TV and things like that. And I was very, very intrigued about the act of resistance. This little social movement. Again, I remember reading about Harriet Tubman when I was in elementary school. She was totally my hero, my God, you know. I could imagine having that kind of courage and things like, you know, she did in the Underground Railroad. And it was this real interest, which I think led me then to romanticize these movements and forms of activism a great deal. And it was that romanticization which also led me to study them when I was in graduate school in the 1980s back in UCLA. I was just, you know, I had to figure them out. What are they? How do they work? You know, how does one do this kind of stuff? And as Caitlin said in the introduction, for me, my primary focus within movements has been about race and class, and particularly how does racism and class exploitation work together to shape people's lives, and how do people articulate an anti-racist and a class-based politics as they're trying to improve their own situation as well as to change the world. Those are my, you know, my particular obsessions. And so I studied these things for many years, as Caitlin mentioned, and I understood their works and all. I lost my romanticism of these movements, which I think was a very healthy thing, to see them in their, you know, the good, the bad, and the ugly that goes with it. And in no way did that detract from my respect or understanding the importance of social movements. I used to think, like when I was a graduate student and when I was like an early professor, I used to think that social movements were one way of changing the world for the dispossessed, right? And I kind of believe that. Like, there's electoral politics, yeah. And I certainly don't think that now. I think social movements and activism are the only way to change the world for the dispossessed. So they're incredibly important. Having said that, though, I think we're at a particular point in time, historically, where I think the power of capital, as well as its allied reactionary forces, are incredibly powerful. I think it's very frightening. I'm scared. I'm kind of pointing to my life where I'm afraid of what is happening to the world. And I guess it's a two-sided thing. On the one hand, I see enormous capacity, capability, power on the part of capital, right? And I'm seeing a whole lot less in terms of people trying to challenge those movements. Not that they're not trying, I just see less power. And I'll talk a little bit more why I might see it that way. I'm not saying it's true, it's only what I'm seeing, which might lead to some of my kind of discouragement, I think, at this particular moment in time. It's clear to me that we need social movements more than ever these days. And there are very hopeful signs that we can point to, things like Occupy, the Dreamers, which I think is a really exciting kind of movement, and I'm just really inspired, I have to say, by these young people and what they're doing. We can look at some of the work in the prison abolitionist movement, Arab Uprising, of course, or the indigenous movements in South America also, which I think are really profound and quite remarkable. But I think my dismay comes from two things. One is, as I said, what I see is unprecedented power on the right these days, and also kind of where I'm at in the life cycle. Okay, since I was starting, a young adult in my early 20s, I have been politically involved in different types of movements and struggles for a long period of time. And then I had kids 8.5 years ago. So I had kids almost 10 years ago, and I stopped being active outside of, in the community, in that same kind of way. I still was active in other ways, but not in the same way, not in the way that activism, movement building requires a certain kind of commitment, continuity. I didn't do that. I felt it was too hard with my children, and based on my own studies of social movements, I interviewed like lots of women, never men, but it was women who would say, I did this stuff when my children were young, and they really resent it. They resent being taken around to all these meetings, being up until midnight while mom was getting up in the newspaper and stuff like that. And, I didn't want to do that necessarily to my kids. I'm an old mother, and so, when you wait a long time, it's kind of like, you see things a little bit differently, I think, because I've had time to do other things also. So I pulled back from community activism, and I think the fact that I'm not involved in a larger community in a very intimate kind of way, I think I'm more disconnected, I think, at this point, to kind of some of the vibrancy and energy that's happening at the street level. So I think that gives me a kind of jaded view. The other thing, as I said, that really I think influenced my current viewpoint on resistance and social movements is, I said, the unprecedented power of the right. And in particular, what I am really concerned about is the right's ability, its track record in shaping discourse, which I'm thinking is incredibly powerful these days. There's other things, too, that are really important, such as the co-optation of social movements and activists, and I think we've seen elements of this, certainly within the environmental justice movement. People lauded it as a great thing when Bill Clinton created, you know, the EJ Task Force and stuff like that. I didn't necessarily see it that way. Let's just put it that way. There's also the incredible, you know, funding and ability of the right to mobilize millions of people these days. We've got the Koch brothers funding the Tea Party, the tobacco industry. I just read a really interesting article about, you know, being able to make a direct connection between the tobacco industry and the Tea Party as a front. They initially developed them in terms of trying to shrug off greater regulation taxes for the tobacco industry. And then, of course, there's a whole onslaught of neoliberalism we see in our cities. And, you know, I just really am kind of, again, dismayed at the way that people really buy into the whole idea, we've got to cut the budget, without thinking about, well, how does the budget get created? Why do we have a budget of this size? Where is that money going to? Again, I really see that as the ability of the right to shape the discourse, to convince us all, yeah, we need to cut essential services, right, that kind of stuff. And the other part about discourse that's really a very personal story to me is my dad. And I think I've told Ruthie some of this, but she might have heard about this. So my dad was a staunch union man for his entire working career, which I don't know how long he worked. He worked like, you know, 60 years, maybe 55 years he worked. He was a union man. He was a dock worker down here in the Long Beach, San Pedro Harbor. ILWU, Local 13, International Longshoremen Warehouse Union, which has a very proud union history. And, you know, it's from my dad, I think, that I originally got my kind of class politics, you know. Hearing him talk on a daily basis about the struggles off the dock, loading, unloading, he would talk about the shippers, who were mostly Japanese at the time, and, you know, how they would negotiate union, all different kinds of conflicts there were. I hear about the bosses, and there are all these levels of hierarchy, right, in terms of this particular kind of industry that I would hear about. And I absorbed a lot of that from him. And so my dad was never, I think, the greatest on race politics. Something his children challenged him on very early on. And I saw real movement as time went on, so that is encouraging. But anyway, my dad really did have some very strong class politics. And about 4 or 5 years ago, his brother-in-law, my uncle, he told my dad about Bill O'Reilly. And he told him about, I remember Nino saying, look, like, he really tells it like it is. This is the truth, what Bill O'Reilly has to say, right? And so my dad started watching Bill O'Reilly. And I saw over this period of time, 4 or 5 years, I saw my dad's politics shift. Very, very radical, all right? From being somebody who was very much a very, you know, he was never radical, but very clearly, strongly Democrat, working class, identified, understand business, you know, tax as a form of subsidy to the wealthy. He understood that stuff on a very gut level. And it's just like all change. It all changed. So I think about Bill O'Reilly a lot. It is a painful thought. I got that. But I think it's thinking about Bill O'Reilly, which really led me to think more about, or really inspired me in some ways, to think about a People's Guide to LA. Because I see a People's Guide to LA as very much of a popular education kind of project. I see it as, you know, it's one of those key linchpins, I hope, in terms of my goal is that it will fall into the hands of people who may or may not have a political, critical kind of consciousness. And I'm hoping it will help to develop that kind of critical consciousness, which is essential then for people becoming activism, right? Being drawn to the world of social movements. So I see it working in that way, or that at least is one of my hopes, that it would work in that direction. So for me, that's been like a big shift in terms of actually studying social movements, being a part of social movements, to thinking about these larger issues like around discourse and political consciousness. Now, I've always had an interest in political consciousness, but this is a different kind of thing for me. It's a different way of intersecting with a larger kind of resistance politics than I have in the past. And I want to continue doing the work on the People's Guide. We actually are hoping we have a team developing a New York one, but we also have one for Detroit, Atlanta, and I just got an inquiry about Chicago, which I'm very excited, and San Francisco, that I'm very excited about. So, you know, I see these as spreading. Our goal is to have them globally, all around the world in all the major cities, at least starting off, although I can see one along the US-Mexican border, maybe a Palestinian one. But, you know, that's what I see them right now as popular education kinds of tools. And I also see that over the, I don't know how many years I've been studying, you know, social movements. When I started, in the 80s, I don't think I had an adequate understanding of the different kinds of forces of exploitation and repression. I think I do understand racism now after many years, but I have a lot to learn, I think, about capitalism and about different kinds of historical moments in capitalism and how that is shaping the landscape that people are responding and reacting to, and how those different historical eras connect to each other, as well as those different geographic spaces. So I think that's some of the things that I'm going to be focusing a lot more on in the coming years. And I do see that as related very much because it emanates from my interest in resistance, but I think it's got to go for me the other side a little bit now, so maybe I can come back then and have a fuller understanding about resistance and social movements. So I'll stop there. And here's for my esteemed colleague.
Thank you.
We can't hear
you.
Oh, Ruthie, you muted yourself so you wouldn't say anything. Yes.
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 Okay, I did mute myself so all my wrestling didn't interrupt the words of my esteemed colleague from California. I'm going to sound like a congressman if I'm not careful. The gentlewoman from California. Thank you all of you for inviting me to do this. And I have to confess that about 9:30 tonight, I wondered why I said yes. But now I know. I mean, as soon as Jen tuned me in, I knew why I said yes. This is really exciting. It's fun to be with Laura, and it's really fun and interesting and inspiring to be able to talk with you all tonight. So, I think, what do I want to say in my preliminary remarks? One thing I'd like to point out. Wendy, in her lovely introduction, please always introduce me. Loved it. Talked about that chapter of mine that you all read, Mothers Reclaiming Our Children. And I thought maybe I'd bring you up to date on what has happened since I closed that chapter of that book, because things have changed enormously. And the things that have changed connect with all of those forces, material and ideological, that Laura's been talking about for the last little while. So, as you will recall, the people, mostly mothers and Mothers Rock, had embarked on building a movement, right, toward the end of that chapter, and they did a couple of things. On the one hand, they formed a 501c3 because it seemed like a way to consolidate a certain capacity. And on the other hand, not necessarily separated from the C3, but also not driven by it, they started Families to Amend California's Three Strikes, because they'd come to the realization that the only people who were going to change things were people like themselves. Well, during the last regular election cycle in California, amazingly, after 19 years of struggle, the people, in fact, Families to Amend California's Three Strikes, and the allies, they built statewide, and in some cases nationally, over the last 19 years, managed to persuade the voters of California to approve a reform to that law. Now, it doesn't end the problem, it doesn't solve the problem, but after 19 years, we won something. and we want something that has actually resulted in people who were doing life without parole being released from prison, having resentencing dates in court, and one by one, a few people are getting out. And you might think, of course, that after 19 years, only having a handful of people get out is not all that luxurious, but it is, because the people who did the work for 19 years know that work matters. The people who came and left know that the work matters. The people who got out, the mostly adult and now quite old adult children of mostly sons of the women in Mother's Rock know the work works. And in the process of those 19 years of struggle, the people in Mother's Rock, the people in Families to Amend California's Three Strikes, and other groups have formed really solid and lively and meaningful coalitions that have together produced some of the other amazing outcomes that we can boast of, actually, in California these days. So currently in California, Governor Jerry Brown, who was the governor of California when I moved there in 1976, is outdoing George Wallace when it comes to proclaiming states' rights and refusing to follow the Constitution. Several people compared Jerry Brown to George Wallace, and when we were writing some publicity last week, we hesitated because we were worried that not enough people would recognize that name, George Wallace. Several generations from Wallace standing in the schoolhouse door. And actually, I'll tell you a funny story. So one of our friends, really brilliant young organizer who lives in Brooklyn, called Ari Wolfeiler, said, oh, I'll find an image and I'll do a mock-up because we're doing this publicity campaign with very striking images and very little text. So he found one of the classic pictures of George Wallace standing in the schoolhouse door, and there were the state police flanking Wallace, and then the federal attorneys serving the subpoena on Wallace, telling him he had to get out of the schoolhouse door. And Ari took the picture, and then he zeroed in on the person he thought was George Wallace, and it wasn't. He zeroed in on the federal attorney and put him in the picture. So we were kind of right.
Sorry.
I hope he doesn't hate me for telling it.
For the world?
Exactly. But what we found in our struggle in California is that all of the work that organizations such as Mother's Rock and Families to Amend California's Three Strikes, and the Central California Environmental Justice Network, and California Prison Moratorium Project, and Californians United for Responsible Budget, which sounds nice and bland, right? And others, the work that we've all done led to, built to the situation that pushed California into the crisis, that led the Supreme Court of the United States today, right, 2 years ago, the current Supreme Court of the United States, to say that California was violating the rights, the constitutional rights of people in its custody, and the proof of that is that a prisoner dies of easily treatable maladies once a week, and that the reason that California is in violation of constitutional rights to the point that prisoners die is that there's too many people in prison and that California cannot build its way out of the problem. So 20 years of work produced this decision in the most unfriendly imaginable Supreme Court since the days when the Supreme Court told George Wallace to get out of the schoolroom door. So where my work has been going recently, in sort of close connection to Laura's in terms of the problems that I think about, that obsess me, and the kinds of solutions that I think I can help people develop by doing good scholarship is all focused on this enormous group of people. One of them is, you know, pretty well known, and the Dreamers are an example of it, and that is the huge group of people who are not documented to work, right? So that's one group of people. The other group, which in the United States numbers about 65 million or more, are people who are documented not to work.
Mm-hmm.
You follow me?
Mm-hmm.
So there are those not documented to work, and there are those who are documented not to work because of felony convictions and other issues from a criminalized past that carries through the present on into a perpetual future of dispossession and vulnerability. And so what I've been doing is thinking and talking and trying to write this year that I'm on sabbatical about the ways that people in these two groups, which obviously have a lot of overlap, where they actually meet. Where in their everyday lives do these people meet? And what are the possibilities for building solidarity and movement between and among such people? I've taken lessons from what we learned in California, even though we haven't by any means learned everything, in order to think about the entire landscape of, for example, the informal economy. And in thinking about the entire landscape of the informal economy, the questions I ask myself are questions like, well, who works where, under what circumstances? What is the shape of their, say, daily commute? What's the shape of their weekly commute? I mean, for example, we know that there are people who live in New York City, who live in New York, in Manhattan, Chinatown, but who work as far away as Toronto and St. Louis, right? And their commutes, their weekly commutes, stretch their lives that way. We also know that there are people who cycle back and forth between the downstate counties of New York and the downstate counties of California, between there and prison towns, either involuntarily as people in captivity or as family members, advocates, and so forth. So I think about the shape of their lives. And I try to imagine the many ways that those movements move through and actually constitute an enormous informal economy in which the actual everyday practices of people, to the extent that they're not organized, might become organized, and to the extent that they are already organized, can become more closely aligned with and connected to the work and the organizing of people like themselves. So that is what I've been doing with sort of all of my time. And I'm trying to see it now also here in Europe, because structural adjustment, which is rolling through Southern Europe, and I know you've all read about this in the newspapers, has produced, as you can imagine, enormous unemployment. It's unbelievable to see how, for example, the state of Portugal was compelled by the European Central Bank, the IMF, and the European Commission to, at one fell swoop, lay off a full 5% of the entire working population of this country. Happened all at once. And everybody else has taken salary cuts between 10 and 30% of their public employees. So I'm seeing the informal economy start to rise here before my very eyes, but also a lot of desperation. And a lot of desperation that can take the form of racist, anti-immigrant activity, but in other cases is taking the form of greater solidarity, as the recent demonstrations in the city suggest. It's workers of all kinds are leaning in the direction of solidarity and leaning against the direction of xenophobia, exclusion, nationalism, and so forth. So I'm encouraged by that, but like Laura, I'm really frightened. I'm frightened of the time we live in. And I'm frightened of how much well, to go back to Laura's example about her dad, about how powerful somebody like Bill O'Reilly is and how powerless we are against him, and therefore how imaginative we must be to think about how to talk to people who we can't reach through Fox, and will never reach through Fox, or MSNBC for that matter. I mean, Rachel Maddow isn't going to save us either. So, I think I've used my opening remarks time plus.
Thank you.
Thank you both.
Can I ask questions of Ruby?
Yes, of
yes,
course.
I could ask you too.
So, one of the things that I want to know, Ruby, and I didn't know you shared my level of fright that I do. But I appreciate you very much telling the story about what's happening, because those are really important reminders, right? And, you know, I guess for me too, one of the things that, you know, when you think about really like embarking like on a huge project like, you know, changing the prison industrial complex or destroying it, you know, it's longevity, right? Really, really longevity. Being able to stick with a battle for, you know, one's life in many cases. And, I'm wondering, like, what you see, you've obviously seen, these are people who work for 19 years, but I'm wondering, to what extent do you see this being a challenge for activism today, activists today, the issue of longevity?
That's a good question. I have to tell you that I'm constantly surprised by how many people hang in.
Yeah.
And also almost always amazed by how people might move from working really intensively on one thing to another, but in that move they're not abandoning the one thing, but rather bringing the sort of principles and goals of the one thing to another. For example, my friend and hero, Rose Brass, who was doing prison work with me for years and years and years, who's now doing more focused work on environmental issues, but the prison stuff is all there as well, right? In terms of vulnerabilities, of modestly educated women and men who are extremely vulnerable to all of the ambient toxins, both those produced as byproducts of capitalist production and those produced more deliberately through the organized abandonment of such people, and that, you know, she puts these things together. And so I do see people who stay and who are constantly changing, as you are, who change often the focus of what they do, but they keep on doing it. Yes. Now, some people would say I changed a lot. I mean, when I started on this, we're going to tear down the PIC, I was a graduate school dropout. I wasn't going to be a professor, you know. So, I mean, for some people, when I went back to school, they thought, "Oh well, she's gone.
Yeah,
she's got her career to worry about now." Rather than this was the only way I could figure out how to put, you know, bread on the table and be able to keep on doing what I did. So here I am, right, doing it. I don't know. What do you think?
I think this is an interesting question and challenge here. There is the need to put food on the table, right? And how do people balance that? Because I think that I have seen, particularly in terms of like, you know, the different movements that I have studied or been part of them too is like, it's around life cycle issues too, about, you know, particularly young people being involved with the shock troops out there doing much, much of the work, right? And then people like have different needs, like, God, I gotta think about retirement, or I have to, you know, maybe they're gonna have children, or different kinds of things. And so I actually think that's a really important kind of cultural issue for us to think about, as well as when to think about it in a material context. How do we build the kind of infrastructure, if you will, to allow people to be activists for life? You know, I think that's a really pressing issue. Like, I recently, you know, I was part of the Strategy Center for a number of years, and there was a guy there, we were the same age actually, and he eventually left again because of like, one might say worker concerns, right?
Mm-hmm.
About old age, about stuff like that, and so there's that kind. And then there's the people who are just like full-time volunteers, right? Which I imagine most of the folks like from other Schwab are, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so, in that case, I mean, I know there's material issues for many of these women, but also there's kind of like the social and the spiritual kinds of concerns, the emotional, how, you know, they keep going.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and maybe when it comes to your kids, you know, maybe that's sufficient fuel, I don't know.
Mm-hmm.
Although, you know, I have to say that this is something I tried very hard to represent in Mother's Rock. I got beat up for it, actually, by a bunch of people.
Mm-hmm.
That Mother's Rock, for a lot of, no, they didn't beat me up, they liked it.
Yeah.
But people who read it and heard it get nervous. And that is that for the people in Mother's Rock, that whole thing, that whole being, was no less part of their sort of spiritual life than of their household life. I mean, it was reproduction in the deepest sense imaginable that people were doing. And as a result of that, some of the people who worked the hardest on that weak little reform of the law that finally passed recently, after four tries.
I didn't realize it was four.
Oh, Jesus Christ. Four tries, really, and let me tell you, just in case you didn't know, that to get an initiative on the ballot in the state of California, you have to collect the number of signatures equal to, I forget what the percentage is, of the number of people who
mm-hmm.
voted in the prior election.
Mm-hmm.
And it's like hundreds of thousands of signatures, and you can't do it with volunteers. It's impossible. It's impossible. So even though it's free, which is to say $200, to do the paperwork to propose an initiative, it costs huge money to actually get something on the ballot. So after trying to do it with volunteers, Mother's Rock eventually got some friends to bankroll paying signature gatherers, right? But early on, when somebody with very deep pockets was willing to bankroll signature gatherers, so somebody also wanted them to say what was going to be the content of the reform, of course, not surprising. And this caused, you know, a huge, you know, internal struggle. Well, should we take the money and take this reform, which is kind of pissy? Or should we not take the money and have no possibility, which is kind of terrible? And, you know, so this is sort of working through these crises time after time after time. Mother's Rock finally pulled that out. But where I was going, sorry, this point is that some of the people who worked the hardest, who are still the backbone of Mother's Rock, knew their kids weren't getting out on this one. There was no chance their kids were getting out,
right?
Or their husbands, or their wives, or their mothers. But they did it anyway, because it is this life.
Right.
And it's a life that, as hard as it is, does sustain people, because people have sort of come into being sort of as the subjects of their own history through purpose. Right? So they don't control the world, but they actually control how they feel about and how they interact in the world.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
Which is no small thing, I think. It's not everything. These folks still want their loved ones out of prison. Don't get me wrong. But I think that the sustaining part has to do with that.
Well, yeah, if you don't, then what does that mean about A, who you are, two, what your life will be like, and perhaps even, you know, seeing one day your loved one out, you know, it's a form of empowerment in that way, even if it's not going to result in the final end result that you want. It has to be. Well, that's a very good story. I hear about that. That's an interesting one. Well, I don't understand why people were critical about that.
What?
I don't know. People were critical about that.
About what?
About what you said in the chapter.
Oh, they were critical because, oh my God, I will tell you. As a matter of fact, it was at the Graduate Center of the City University of New York, where I presented some of my findings when I was still a lowly graduate student. And I talked about the part about how every Mother's Rock meeting begins and ends with prayer. Remember that part?
Yes.
And the prayer sets the agenda. Sets and summarizes the agenda. And I got some women waylaid me in the hall after my talk and said, "We resent that you characterized what these women achieved as something that was a result of their prayer and their Christianity, when what they did was use their reason in order to figure out how to work the system successfully."
Oh,
and then, so they were mad at me both that I didn't say, praise the women by saying they used their reason instead of, I don't know what they thought I was doing by saying no, they think they used their prayer. And also they were freaked out because they didn't want Christianity to have anything to do with the post-revolutionary world.
Yeah. Oh, I can be sympathetic to that, but they're still missing it.
I remember this woman just spitting at me. They use their reason. She's not in the room tonight.
That's funny.
Well, there's one other thing I was thinking about, though, Laura, and it's, in the 80s, when you first started studying social movements, and some folks in the room, even if you weren't studying social movements in the 80s, have probably read a lot of the work that people wrote in the 80s about social movements. And then into the early 90s, there was a tendency that at first was pretty mind-expanding to try to locate the resistance in every possible aspect of everyday life. And the mind-expanding part was to think, well, there are many more things that we can do and that we do than we recognize. So let's put some thought into recognizing it. But then that, it's the caricature of that work, and to some degree, some of the work caricatures itself, started representing everything that anybody did who wasn't, the man as resistance.
I remember that vividly.
Remember?
And I had a very strong reaction to that.
It was like everything was resistance. And so what I think maybe what we face now, tell me what you think, Laura, is that we have to sort of try to bring the good thinking of the resistance is everywhere back without falling, prey to the notion that all you have to do is point at something, say it's resistance, and you're done.
Right.
Because if we don't sort of get that sort of richness of resistance in many aspects of life back into the front of our consciousness, then the situation is so dire, I think people will feel hopeless and find support in, if not Bill O'Reilly, then maybe a form of religion that tells you to check out rather than to step up.
Right. I have a funny story. I remember being, when I was like a young professor, this would have been like around 91 or something like that, and I was teaching a graduate seminar, and we were reading some of this literature about resistance. And I remember one of my students said, "So if somebody farts, is that an accident?" It was just like so silly. And I also think I have a lot of biases towards some of that literature sometimes. Because I think that I have been closed-minded or not fully appreciative, I think that's it, of the power, for example, of art, right? Very broadly defined, in terms of inspiring, encouraging oppositional consciousness and creating new possibilities. And that is something that, you know, I have changed my thinking of that, I'm happy to say. I've evolved to consider more of that. But it is, and there actually are really some, there are some really interesting things happening. I think, like, even in my local community, there are these more different kinds of forms of resistance that can be incorporated or can be stepping stones to something else. You know, I think I've been the kind of person that those privileged social movements, as I said earlier. And I think there's good reason for that, but I think I need to put them in better, you know, more contextualized. Mm-hmm. It's one form of resistance, yeah. I was listening on Terry Gross this morning. I started this. No, it's Democracy Now! Yesterday, that was it. And she interviewed Michael Pollan, right? Mm-hmm. And he was talking about the most important thing we can do in the world is to start cooking our own food, right? And so I was thinking about that. You know, I didn't, she hadn't finished hearing the whole interview, so I want to go back and hear it. But I think that's a really, it's a really intriguing statement, right? Cooking our own food. You know, what would be the consequences, like for McDonald's, for all the other kinds of food processors, you know, if we altered food, right? Mm-hmm. It would have a huge effect. I don't know what kind of effect, but it would have a huge effect on the economy.
Would have a huge effect on the economy, which brings us back to capitalism. And which actually is the problem here. Actually connects to the what we were discussing about resistance being everywhere, but not everything is resistance. And certainly there has been for a long time, but very pointedly in the last few years, a kind of resurgence of consumer activism. Mm-hmm. And for example, I think some of you have probably seen that certain manufacturers will have a label called Red, and Red means if you buy that thing, you know, 10 cents of the profit will go to some starving person somewhere. You know, that's sort of, you can buy your way, not buy like by the ballot referendum thing, but buy like just shop your way to a post-dispossessed world, which is kind of silly. But that said, there still is something in the tool of the boycott that people in many places are trying to think about, think through very carefully. And this is something that Laura works out really beautifully in her first book, Environmentalism and Economic Justice, in how the, works through how the United Farm Workers try to figure out a number of different ways that different kinds of people who might otherwise continue to buy iceberg lettuce or whatchamacallit, grapes, not the lettuce and grapes, confused, but different ways that people could participate in the UFW's movement, right? So people who weren't coming very close to the UFW could send a check, and other people could not buy the thing, and other people could hang up a sign, and there were all these different ways to get people involved and have them participate in a labor action that needed the concerted attention of what used to be thought of as an invisible weapon, and that is the boycott. So today, of course, there are people, for example, who are working to develop boycotts and divestments and sanctions with firms that do business in the occupied territories of the West Bank and Gaza. And there are other people who are trying to develop boycotts around other products. Those things, I think, can still be powerful, but I wonder about the extent to which people imagine their still is no alternative to capitalism. I mean, what do you think?
Wait, so when people imagine, you mean despite the boycott? I don't understand.
The boycotts are, they think the boycotts are the answer because there's no alternative to capitalism.
Oh.
And the boycott is a sort of engagement with capitalism.
Hmm.
You see what I'm saying?
I do think there's a lot of people that don't, I think the vast majority of people don't think there's a capitalism. Crowds, you know, the light crowd. You know? Yeah, I definitely think that, you know, most people do not see an alternative to capitalism. And I think that the boycott is, I think that most people see the boycott as actually, you know, a separate issue than capitalism in their head, right?
Mm-hmm.
That's what I think that they see it as. Yeah, and I think that comes from partly by really maybe partly being shaped so much by the early work of UFW, when they did not see that, right? So they saw that within the still larger framework, because in fact they were never questioning capitalism, right?
Mm-hmm.
That wasn't there, and you know, when I think about like the one like in the BDS, right? You know, what's happening in terms of Palestine? I think because it's a lot of academics, I think people are able to bring a different kind of analysis to it that's not necessarily the ones that we might hear from a different kind of crowd. I think it becomes it's become more, you know, a more self-selected kind of group. I mean, all boycotts are self-selected. We have more widespread appeal than others. Let's put it in. And so I think that's a very particular kind of one that would allow people to make those kind of connections. Now, you know, an interesting thing to think about, though, would be like the South Africa one, right, against apartheid. And that's where we did see people, I think, very much making those connections.
Mm-hmm.
I was, you know, again, I was, this is 1980s LA, where I was at, I don't know where you were at the time.
LA.
We didn't even but, you know, I was hearing very clearly those critiques for that for the South African one, and those I thought were very, very powerful, and very, very exciting to hear those kinds of critiques. You know, I was at a session at the AAG this past, you know, a couple weeks ago, right, when it was in LA, and I went to one of the sessions that they had about, I don't know what they call it. It was, you know, against capitalism, or, you know, they were actually, I know, how's that Google title? But there were actually these people from all doing all these like little small projects that were non-capitalist projects, which I found was like really totally exciting, actually. Which brings us back to the other point we were talking about smaller forms of resistance, right? Mm-hmm. So there were people, they were like somewhere up in the Northeast, and they were like going and collecting all the fruit from either public spaces or people that had agreed they could take their fruit. And then they were canning the fruit, all volunteers, and they were giving it away, right? They were giving it away. And I just thought that was really, really, you know, interesting, because on so many ways, it was developing this non-capitalist practice in space, right? Mm-hmm. Not that they're going to smash capitalism with this, but as a really grateful exercise in building tools, experience, thinking, right? This kind of infrastructure for challenging capitalism.
Mm-hmm.
I thought this, and is it a form of consumerism? I'm not sure. Giving away gel, pan fruit?
No, a gift is a gift. Gift economies are good. Gift economy is good. So, should we open up to our friends who have been sitting patiently as we chit and chat? We'll forget and keep talking all night.
We don't do this often.
We haven't seen each other for a while.
I think there are some questions. I know that Jack had a question, and then maybe
but
some
you
other
guys
folks.
Go first. Do you have
Why don't you jump in? Because
okay.
You've had a question for a while.
So I
you can't.
Can we see? Can
yes,
you
go I'll go over here really quickly.
Here, you can sit and see.
Oh, don't move it. It'll drag that computer up.
Oh, thanks so much.
Hi.
Hi, Jeff.
Hi.
I was interested. I just went to the Homo Nationalism and Pinkwashing Conference here at Homo Nationalism and Pinkwashing Conference. Mm-hmm. Lars, like, leaning in closer. Do you know about?
You sound a little wobbly.
Okay. The Homo Nationalism and Pinkwashing Conference.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And that was here at the Graduate Center a few weeks ago. And one of the takeaways that a lot of the more senior faculty had after this conference was that everyone was equating every injustice with every other injustice. That settler colonialism was gentrification, and so on. And what struck me is that the extreme inequality that you were talking about that scares you is making all those issues kind of mush together. And maybe I was wondering if you think that the reason that long-term activists can draw environmental issues together with prison issues is it maybe because the inequality is growing so extreme between the very wealthy and the rest of us that we're starting to see the connections more and more between these issues, that because what we were hearing in so many of the very young scholars or graduate students were focusing on so many issues and saw them all network together. But this led to a lot of conversations around the table. I wanted to get your feedback on that.
I'll go first and then maybe you can add on that. I hadn't thought about that, about the growing inequality leading to this kind of coalescence of different forms of resistance and movements. And I think that's a very interesting idea. I mean, as far as I can remember, activists have always said, we have to find common ground, right? That's always been like, you know, we can only come together,
right?
That kind of stuff. And so there's a lot of potential goodwill and energy that can come from that. On the other hand, the scholar in me is, as well as the activist in me, is a little bit more cautious about that for a couple of reasons. I think, one, it's really important, and I think this is, you know, some of the tremendous strength of Ruthie's work, is tracing out, like, well, what are the actual forces that are causing these particular forms of oppression that we might be seeing, all right?
Right, right.
We can talk about prisons, for example, as an example. And once you do that, well, then you can see, or you can kind of map out, well, who then might be your logical allies? Who can you identify that you've got a common kind of material or ideological, connection with, right? In the case of EJ and prisons, and this is, again, something that Ruthie and other NFPs and activists pointed out long ago, there really were huge connections between EJ and anti-prison work. Those were not at all,
right.
Random.
Right.
In any way, shape, or form. There was all kinds of geographic, material, demographic, political connections between these two different kinds of concerns. And so just going on that, I think it's really important for every case or every kind of movement to do that work.
Yeah.
And that's not to say you don't want to be inclusive. That's not to say you don't want to invite anybody who might want to, in fact, support or try to make these other kinds of linkages, but you need to know also, all right, well, who are our potential logical allies, and maybe those people will pan out as allies, but, you have to do that work of trying to connect with those people where it makes logical kind of sense, right?
Right.
And then for the people who are not so logical, it's like, well, what is going on here? If they're people of goodwill, how can we make those kinds of connections? So, and then the question comes that, I didn't say this to Ruthie, but I was thinking about it. Like in the case of the Mother's Rock example, it's an interesting question, and I don't know the answer to it. She might know better. I understand why a parent or a family member who has an incarcerated one, they will spend their life fighting. And that makes perfect sense to me. What's equally interesting or impressive to me are those people that don't have, people locked up. And a lot of them come out of larger political commitment, but how do those other people come in, and what kind of sustaining energy is there for them in those movements? Maybe that's, you can directly speak to me.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, there have been so many people locked up that people who say they don't have anybody in prison are lying.
Yeah.
Or they don't just say that. They don't know. And they rather not know. So there's that. But that doesn't mean that. You said that when you were a kid, Harriet Tubman came across your consciousness and you were really impressed by her. And, what Harriet Tubman did, and she has this great description about how she once knew a man who was sent to the state prison, she says. And he was there for a very long time, decades and decades. And all he could think about was going home and seeing the old people at home and getting back there. And eventually the time came and he was free. And he left the prison and he went back to the town where he lived. And his house wasn't there and his family wasn't there. And she said, there was no one there to take his hand and welcome him back to the world. And then she says, so too with me. I achieved freedom, I achieved that thing I'd always dreamed of. And then when I got to the north, there was no one there to take my hand. And so I decided, I can't do this just for myself. I have to go back and do it over and over and over and over again. Mm-hmm. And I feel like that's the way some people live. I mean, it just is that. So it's not like family as in this is my child or this is my relative or something like that. Or even a friend. I mean, they're strangers, actually. But it's this feeling, for me, it isn't only this, but it's the Black radical tradition. The Black radical tradition, and I'm not saying that that's equal to whatever Black people do that's radical, I'm talking about something quite specific. But the Black radical tradition is something that has accumulated since the first instant that chattel slavery came into being. Came into being thanks to Henry the Navigator, who was once a big shot here in this country where I live now. And the work that people went through to sort of live through that thing and to figure out a way to make freedom meaningful for somebody they didn't know and might never see, because the principle of freedom is the greatest motivation, and the sort of survival of the collective is the purpose of life, that combination, is what Cedric Robinson argues, and I believe underlies what he called, and I call in his honor, the Black radical tradition. And it's a way of being in the world. And one need not be of African descent, although all humans are, and be of that tradition. Right? And when I list people, I always list you. Because it's a tradition that has this energetic sense that the narrative of our lives should unroll as a narrative of freedom. And that we have an obligation and the ability to figure out how to make that happen. So too, as Harriet Tubman said, so too with me. There was no one to take my hand. So I think that there are stories like that in sort of all the great liberation traditions of the last 500 years of modern history. And I also think that the central contradiction of modernity is freedom, that it is the central contradiction. And that one of the things that makes me a Marxist is to understand the relationship of a certain kind of freedom to the possibility of capital expansion, and also the necessity of undoing that so that a greater freedom can be realized by everybody. So that's what I think. So I don't, I, think, I don't know if that answers your question or not.
It doesn't, but it expands my mind to new levels that I needed to go to, so thank you. Does anybody else have?
Yeah, maybe I'll come over here.
Yeah, I'll swap out.
All right.
This is Hector.
Hi, Ruthie. Hi, Laura.
Hi.
Hello. I owe you a report back from the AAG. Good stuff happened, so I'm sorry I haven't gotten down. I want to take up this question of organizing and kind of and being frightened, because I think it is, you know, it is a frightening times that we live in. I teach an undergraduate course at City College, and I've, you know, my students leave class sometimes very frustrated and demoralized because we are discussing international development and the way it's gone wrong for the most part. But I try to give them hope, right? To give them something to give them something to hold on to before they leave class. And today we ended with a story about Rosa Parks, who taught about a week before she refused to give up her seat, she was contemplating leaving the NAACP after organizing for about 14 years. And she was really demoralized. She thought things wouldn't change. And a week later, the bus boycott is launched. So, you know, it's this kind of, I guess I kind of like to hold on to that adage, that saying that's the night is darkest before the dawn. And I think the question of hope is really important in fighting for something else as activists. And it's certainly, I think, for me, it's reinvigorating when I'm around other organizers, because their energy, or other activist scholars, because their energy also recharges my energy. And then I can come to class and say, no, we can't lose hope, right? But this question of hope, I think, is really important. Like, you know, Harvey Milk, one of his biggest statements organizing in San Francisco was that you have to give people hope. And it's very difficult to imagine the end of capitalism. As we've been talking about, it seems like it's easier to imagine the end of the world. But, you know, is there, what about the question of hope within this dialectic of freedom, right? This other side of the coin of modernity that is freedom. Like, where does that fit in? And I don't think we can leave this up to chance, but I think that within this struggle for something else, that, you know, I guess I'm an optimist and the glass is half full. That's how I see things. But if you could expand on that a little more.
Who's
the
elf?
We agree with you. It's really important, right? People banana, as Jesse would say. No, it's really, you know, there's two things about what you said there. And again, I mean, as you can see, I'm thinking a lot about longevity and activism. But there's a physics to it. That, you know, that's very real, right? And you actually really do get, not imaginary, not just metaphorical, you get actual energy from other people, right? And if you've ever been part of a mass movement, you know that, you have felt it, what it is. So it's incredibly important, that energy. And then part of that energy, it has to go in two ways, right? Or, to think about it. One of it has to be about critiquing, and the other, it has to be about what do we want to build, right? There's the two parts to it. And what becomes really important is, you know, if you're critiquing, if you're intent on destroying something, how are you going to go? What kind of energy are you going to use in the destruction of something? Let's talk about capitalism, right? You know, not that I can imagine that we could destroy capitalism. I do see us potentially as building alternatives to capitalism, right? I know, like, some people talk to, you know, and so maybe we're still existing. And look at it, in my head, I can't imagine a non-capitalist world. All I can do is imagine spaces for, or perhaps a mixed economy, if you will, right? Capitalist and non-capitalist kind of economy. But that's where the hope, I think, does come in. It's very, very important. I know, I don't know what to say about it. I know I always try to write my books and my scholarly work and leave it on a message of hope. Try to pull out the positive story after kind of sometimes really downers. because it's so important. And particularly for students, you know, when I started teaching environmental studies, I had a student who says, oh my God, after I leave your class, I'm ready to go slit my wrists, you know. And, you know, that was an important lesson for me to learn as a teacher, right? That you always, particularly with undergraduates, you have to give them something positive, some hope, and give them tools to do that, right? More than anything, so they can begin their own practice of developing these, you know, oppositional practices that feel good, make a difference. You want to say?
I want to actually pick up on what if when you put your hands, one of your hands was critique. I want to pick up on that and say a little more. And this is serious as a heart attack. And Hector certainly say this when we've had private conversations, and I'm happy to say it for the public record. And that is that being a public scholar or a scholar activist or anything that's got scholar in the name means that you're a scholar. And being a scholar of this stuff that we also want to change is something that sometimes is such a slog, you can't even believe it. I'm really having to read these, you know, statements, these archives, government data, whatever it is. And other times, it fills me with the most joy I can imagine, just figuring stuff out and figuring it out well so that other people can use it. And back to Harriet Tubman, good old Harriet, she went south time after time after time, working in the Underground Railroad, but also as a spy for the Union armies during the Civil War. She was, you know, learning things and figuring out things that other people were going to have to rely on to live. And I take really seriously that if I do something badly in my scholarship, it could really hurt people. If I don't do it well, somebody else might get hurt. I don't really care about my career. It's turned out to be a nice career, but I don't care about my career being hurt. I care about somebody picking up my book saying, oh, this is how things work, and then going off and being bamboozled because I didn't do a good job. And I think that we have the obligation, as well as the like kind of joyful responsibility, to figure out the things that we need to figure them out and do a fantastic job on the scholarly part, so that we can help people make tools that will be, you know, weapons for change. And this is now not about my and Hector's private conversations. This is a general statement. I often get frustrated with colleagues and students who feel that having the opportunity to be paid to think and learn things is somehow beside the point. And I want to remind people that whenever the extreme right takes over any place, they get really organized about getting rid of the intellectuals. They either slaughter them, as they did throughout Latin America and other places, or they defund and do other things to make jobs. And don't tenure people, as happens at Laura's school all the time now and so forth. They do things to get rid of people so that people can't use the time and skills that we have to learn so that other people can learn. And it may be that you are the choir that I'm preaching to now, but I wish you'd repeat this when you have colleagues and classmates who feel like it's beside the point to be doing the kind of work that we do. Just doing it in school doesn't make all the difference, but doing it well so other people can use it, like Laura's books, are you kidding me? They make an enormous difference in the world. So that's my little resistance from the scholars. Look, let me tell you, I've always been a nerd. Like, since I was the littlest kid, I could read when I was really, really little, My parents didn't know what to do with me, but they thought, oh gosh, you can read, that's good, go read. And I never could just keep it to myself, right? So I learned something, and then I need to get an audience so I could tell them what I learned, right? So at the dinner table or at church or, you know, wherever I was. I was telling people, so I finally found a job.
Well, we're very grateful that you brought us together to be able to talk about that kind of scholarly possibility and resistance. And unless there is another question that somebody is just dying to ask, we're going to all give you a round of applause. Thank you very much. Thank you for joining us. This is our last live stream class in reassessing inequality and reimagining the future case study of East Harlem. And all of us who are here to continue discussion about the good scholarly work that you have been doing in community partnerships that will then be presented at Casa Azul next Friday, and hope that anyone who's able will be able to join us. Thank you and good night.